Hello everyone, and you are welcome to the last 2022 meeting on Zona Cartografia. And today we are delighted to be hosting Professor Richard Kane from NYU, that is for sure one of the most well-known researchers in linguistics. It's a great pleasure for us to have you here in our meeting, Professor Kane, and of course for me to be the one chosen to introduce you to our audience. Professor Kane will be talking for us today about suffixal comparatives and suffixal superlatives. And only before passing the floor to him, if you have any questions on Professor Kane's talk, you can post it on YouTube chat or send us the question to the email that will be soon appear on our live stream chat. So thank you very much for taking your time to be here with us, Professor Kane, and the floor is yours.
Thank you. This talk is, despite the title of the handout, this talk is primarily about comparatives and superlatives in English of the suffixal type. But there will be a section toward the end about derived nominals, and the initial section is about English past tense, which at first glance may seem rather distant from superlatives and comparatives, but there is one interesting point of comparison between the two. In part, the background of this talk is the monograph by Jonathan Bobolick on superlatives and comparatives that appeared about 10 years ago. With the his primary claim was that the structure of superlatives properly contains the structure of comparatives. He may or may not be correct about that. I won't be directly addressing that issue, but I will be disagreeing with him on a more specific point. He thought of comparatives as involving a comparative morpheme, that a head that comes in above the adjective, and superlatives as involving a superlative head that comes in above the comparative head. I don't think that's the right way to think about superlatives and comparatives, as I will try to show. In part, this skepticism is related to an earlier paper of mine from about 6 years ago called The Silence of Heads, in which I tried to show that surprisingly many heads that have been postulated in the course of syntactic work over the years have been misanalyzed in part. Let me give one example from that paper. English has a very common kind of question in English is something like, what is your name again? Where again, obviously doesn't modify the predicate is your name. My proposal was that we should think of a question like that in English as having a structure essentially like that of, what is your name? Tell me again. With unpronounced tell me, in a way that is obviously reminiscent of Ross's performative analysis. But as far as the question of heads is concerned, this proposal meant that this final again in that kind of English sentence is not to be analyzed as a sentential head relative to the question itself. Rather, again is an adverb in a higher matrix predicate. Also related to a certain skepticism about heads is a proposal that I made in a paper called Anti-Symmetry in the Lexicon, to the effect that, contrary to Chomsky's remarks on nominalization, nouns don't project in the way that verbs do. So the proposal in that paper was that no noun is a projecting head, that we can call a noun a head, but it doesn't project. And in that sense, it gives you a rather different picture of certain aspects of syntax, and that will be directly related to the discussion toward the end of this talk about derived nominals. But let me get back to the handout itself now. The reason that I bring in past tense in English has to do with the proposal I made in a recent paper to the effect, which is given in one on the handout, that the English ED suffix that one sees in past tense and participles is actually two morphemes. The first of which, that is the vowel spelled E, is much like a romance verbal theme vowel. So the idea is that a form like requested is to be thought of as in two. It's actually request plus E plus D. This carries over to participles, but let's skip that and let's skip certain things here. But let's note just above examples 9 and 10 that English in the past tense and in these participles has quite a few doublets. The set given in that paragraph is a set of doublets that exist in my English. So that's interesting for those of us interested in the morphological question of doublets. But more interesting here is the fact that at least in some cases, these doublets don't have exactly the same interpretation. As you can see in 9 and 10, the form dreamed with ED is perfectly compatible with what you might call an imperfective aspectual reading, whereas the form dreamt without the E is less compatible with it. So that in at least some cases, these doublets seem to differ aspectually. Now, getting closer to, gradually closer to superlatives, let's look at what I have in four here. Everybody knows that in English, you cannot say John goed to the movies last night, and that you say went. In the paper just mentioned, I tried to show that the right way to think of the goed versus went question is to separate the question into two parts. On the one hand, there's the question, you know, what are the properties of went? And on the other hand, there's a distinct question, which is why is goed impossible? And I take the position that it's not sufficient to say that goed is impossible because English has went. Part of the reason for saying that is that it looks like the impossibility of goad is part of a more general fact given in 11 on the handout, which is that all English light verbs are incompatible with the theme vowel E in the past tense. That is, the ED ending is impossible for the entire set of verbs in 12, as shown in 13. The reverse is not true, but the fact of 12 seems to be a hard fact, setting aside the question of how we define the notion light verb. And we can ask why 11 should hold in the first place. Let's think about it from a Hale and Kaiser perspective, which I render as in 14. Hale and Kaiser said that many more verbs than you might think are denominal So a verb like sleep in English is actually light verb plus nominal sleep. This leads to 14. One characterization of light verbs is that they are exactly the class of verbs that are not denominal. That is, they don't involve noun incorporation of any sort. That doesn't mean they don't involve incorporation of some sort. There might be multi-verb incorporation in some cases, but light verbs are not denominal. Then we get to 15. And 16 is interesting. It looks like what we can say about English is that this theme vowel-like morpheme E requires the presence of an incorporated noun. And that's why you don't find it with light verbs. We can ask, in addition, the question at the beginning of section 6, why is ed the elsewhere case in English past tense and participles? Everybody knows that English has either ed or t/d. I'll assume that the alternation between t and d in the absence of e is just phonology. And then, of course, English has many cases with a zero suffix. It's common, in a way that goes back to Panini, to think that the way to talk about this is to say that there's a specific smallish class of verbs that has a zero suffix, and we specify that, and then there's a smallish class that has the TD suffix, and we specify that, and then we say that everything else is ED. I mean, that looks accurate, but it leaves open the question, why is it exactly ED that's the elsewhere case? That way of putting it, that is the Panini-like way of putting it that you find in the work of most morphologists, would be equally compatible with the zero suffix being the elsewhere case, or the bare TD suffix being the elsewhere case. What I want to propose is, given in 17, that is, in essence, the heart of the proposal is that specifying something as the elsewhere case is not satisfactory. We want to ask why the elsewhere case is that specific morpheme or combination of morphemes. So I give the answer in 17, ed is the elsewhere case because all, quote, new verbs are denominal. Now, it's not so easy to specify what we mean by new verb, but one aspect of this is that in sports discussions, arguably all verbs that are specific to one sport or another are new in this sense. So for example, in baseball, American baseball, we have this nice minimal pair, 18 and 19. 18 is a banal sentence that has nothing to do with baseball, but within the game of baseball, the verb fly is used in a certain way, illustrated in 19. And when it's used in this baseball sense, the past tense is flied rather than flew. The idea would be that in the baseball sense of fly, the verb is necessarily denominal, whereas in 18, it's not so clear, let's say. Now, if 16 is correct, 16 was the idea that the theme vowel like E requires the presence of an incorporated noun, we can ask, why should 16 hold? One possible answer is that this E morpheme needs an incorporated N, because this E morpheme is actually a determiner, perhaps related to the vowel of the or up. If so, that may suggest that incorporation of a completely determinerless noun is not available. Now we know that it's been proposed that arguments must have a determiner, but the question of incorporated nouns has always been, it's always been unclear whether they were to count as full arguments or not. This consideration here suggests that they must be. Now let's move on to superlatives finally. The point here being at the beginning of this part about superlatives, that's the superlative ending EST has something interesting in common with the past tense ending ED. English has seven irregular superlatives listed in 21. Some of them are not superlatives, strictly speaking, but I think they all go together. These irregular superlatives all have the property that they lack the normal E of the EST ending that superlatives have in English. The fact that they lack the E is reminiscent of the fact that irregular English past tense verbs all lack the E. This leads to 22, which is a proposal that's intended to track the earlier discussion of past tense ED. Superlative EST is actually bimorphemic, with E being a separate morpheme. Obviously, now question arises for comparatives. Is that also true for comparative ER? Interestingly, surprisingly, the answer may be no. You can't actually construct a list of irregular comparatives that would match 21. The only real irregular superlative, I'm setting aside suppletion here. So it's at least possible that comparatives differ in that the comparative ER suffix is not bimorphemic. This potential distinction may be reinforced by the facts that I begin to discuss in 23. English allows prenominal prepositional phrase modifiers of a certain idiomatic sort, but there are quite a lot of them. I give, I think, five of them in 23. Remarkably, to my ear, but also for a certain number of other speakers that I've asked, the corresponding superlatives are actually marginally acceptable to one degree or another, as given in 24. For example, that's the off-the-wallest remark I've ever heard you make. What's of particular interest, in part, related to Bobolik's monograph, is that the corresponding comparatives, to my ear, are appreciably less acceptable than the superlatives in 24. And we can actually construct minimal pairs, as in 26. English has the convenient property that you can have phrases like the taller of the two children with a comparative form, but a superlative interpretation. And therefore you have minimal pairs like the tallest of the three, the taller of the two. And as you can see in 26, the superlative one, when you take these prepositional phrase modifiers, is systematically better than the comparative one. And for me, the comparative one is completely out. It's not without interest to note that all of these superlatives involving prepositional phrase modifiers have the property that the E of the EST superlative morpheme must appear. So 27 is completely out of the question. This leads to 28. It may be that these prepositional phrase superlatives of the sort seen in 24 and 26 are in fact licensed by this E. This leads to various questions that I don't have answers for. But let's just jump to 29. Speakers disagree sometimes about the absolute judgments, but in a way that's often useful in syntactic work, we can nonetheless come up with a very sharp generalization given in 29. In these prepositional phrase cases that I've just discussed, nobody finds the comparatives better than the superlatives. In other words, putting it another way, there are many speakers like myself who find the superlatives better. Some speakers find them equally marginal, but nobody finds the comparatives better. Now, this gets even more interesting if we look at 30, which is a familiar fact, namely that the English comparative suffix is marginal or impossible when the adjective is multisyllabic. Morphophonologists have worked on this. The basic fact is given in 30 with an adjective like important. Using the suffix is essentially impossible. You have to have more important. What's of interest is that superlatives, and again, relevant to Bobolik's monograph, superlatives and comparatives resist suffixation. These multisyllabic adjectives have the property that they resist suffixation to an unequally in superlatives and comparatives. More specifically, in various cases, the superlative with a multisyllabic adjective is less bad than the corresponding comparative. And this is shown in the examples in 31. For example, the unstoppablest of the three basketball players is much better to my ear, even if it's not perfect, it's much better to my ear than the unstoppabler of the two basketball players. And similarly, for the rest of the examples, the ill-fatedest of the three expeditions is marginal, but clearly better than the ill-fateder of the two expositions. Why should this be? What it suggests is that, I mean, what I would like to think is true, but remains to be seen, is that the prepositional phrase facts that we looked at, seeing that the superlatives were better than the comparatives, and these facts about multisyllabic adjectives are the same fact. And what's perhaps at issue is the FOFC constraint that's been discussed by people like Ian Roberts and Michelle Sheehan and Anders Holmberg, Teresa Biebrauer in recent work going back at least 10 years. What's at issue is the idea that on a left branch, you can't have a certain kind of right branching structure. That could be relevant to the prepositional phrase facts, although there are challenges in understanding why the effect is sometimes stronger than other times. It's possible in a way that actually recalls a discussion by Michelle Sheehan in a 2017 book on FOFC effects, that the facts of 31 reflect an FOFC violation. The phonological, that is, it could be that these complex multisyllabic adjectives have internal structure of a sort that mimics, that sort of tracks or is similar to syntactic structure in such a way that the FOFC constraint sees it. And it sees it to the point that it actually creates a strong violation with comparatives and a weaker violation with superlatives. If true, this feeds into the longstanding question about the degree to which phonological structure might be similar to syntactic structure, recalling work, government phonology work of the 1980s. So in part, what I've tried to show here is that superlatives and comparatives differ from each other in ways that might be compatible with Bobolik's idea that superlative structures properly contain comparative structures, but it remains to be seen whether that's true. In any case, I'll come back to the, as I mentioned at the beginning, I'll be coming back to the Bobolik question later. There's another difference between superlatives and comparatives, which is given in 32 versus 33. English has a set of, quote, words of the form leftmost, rightmost, etc., which have no comparative counterparts at all. The analysis of leftmost might be as in 34. There's a question about why a comparable structure is not possible with comparatives. Maybe it has to do with the E morpheme that's part of the superlative structure, but not arguably part of the comparative structure. Another fact about this series of cases like leftmost, rightmost, is that there's no comparable series left least, right least, top least, et cetera, completely out. The difference between leftmost and left least recalls an interesting point that Bobolik made in his monograph, which was that cross-linguistically, there seems to be no comparative suffix that would be interpreted as less. Let's skip over a few things here. And let's now ask why most and least should differ as they do with respect to the series leftmost versus left least. As I say, starting at 46, there may be a link here to a fact related to things that Jackendoff talked about a long time ago. English has the property that among the so-called degree words, enough is incompatible with much and many, as opposed to other degree words, so that how much, too much, as much are all perfectly fine, but neither enough much nor much enough is possible in the same with many. Jackendoff proposed a rule deleting much and many in the context of enough, indicated essentially in 46 and 47. But there's a question that Jackendoff didn't, so I agree with Jackendoff's proposal, but there's a further question that we can ask, which is, how come English has a deletion, how come English can delete much and many in the context of enough, while English cannot delete little and few in the context of enough? partly as indicated by the fact that 48 and 49 are well formed, and partly by the fact that a sense like they have enough money cannot conceivably be interpreted as 48. Now, everybody would agree that English cannot delete little or few in the context of enough. I mean, the facts are clear. But the question is, why not? You're formulating a deletion rule, a deletion operation that can delete much and many, could be tweaked very easily to allow deletion of little or few. The proposal I'd like to make is that little and few, which we know, as we see in 50, we know that few in English licenses negative polarity items, at least to some extent. The proposal that I'd like to make here, that I actually made a while back, is that the way in which few licenses a negative polarity item has to do with the structure given in 51. That is, few has the property that it co-occurs with negation. So that it's, in other words, what I'd like to propose is that the sense in which few is negative-like is exactly the sense illustrated in 51. Few itself is not negative. It's rather that it has the property that it co-occurs with a silent negation. And it's that silent negation that is, strictly speaking, the licensor of the negative polarity items. So that a phrase like few enough friends or little enough money should be understood as in 52 and 53, actually containing a silent not. And now the proposal is that the reason, that is the beginning of her proposal, is that the reason that English can delete much and many in the context of enough, but not few and little, is that the presence of this silent not interferes with that deletion in a way that we'll have to spell out more carefully in the future. Similarly, for the case of leftmost versus left least, for leftmost, we can have something like 54. By extension from the discussion of few and little, least, which is obviously related to little, will also co-occur with silent negation. Therefore, the structure for left least, were it to exist, would have to be as in 55, which would be exactly like 54, except that there'd be this extra silent not. And the idea is that this silent not in 55 will actually interfere with the derivation. Let's say more specifically, if we take 54 to involve movement of the phrase to the left from a post-nominal position, or at least actually only crucially from a post-most position, the idea is that a parallel movement of to the left in the case of least would have to cross not, silent not, and that might be rendered impossible by something like the negative island constraint of the sort discussed by Rizzi and others. Time is moving on, so let me skip a few things here. There is an important question concerning superlatives and comparatives having to do with the interpretation of the suffixes. Well, this is related to the fact, to the possible proposal illustrated in 59 for superlatives and in 62 for comparatives, that the suffixal superlatives and comparatives of English are actually accompanied by a silent most or more. This is related to work by Norbert Korver, seems plausible. Now we can note that if 62, say, is the right way to think about comparatives, we could say that the comparativeness of the interpretation of 62 is actually conveyed specifically by more, silent more. If so, then the ER suffix won't have to convey the notion of comparative itself. And note that more is itself complex. All of this has to do with what I proposed a while back in 2005, something I called a decompositionality principle, which a view that I share with nanosyntax. And that is the view that an individual morpheme cannot be interpretively complex. It can have one interpretable feature, but not more than one. Therefore, if we think that that's true, then a comparative suffix ER could not simultaneously express what is expressed by much and whatever is expressed by comparison itself, and similarly for superlatives. There are also questions about what are possible suffixes, but I will skip those. Now we come to the heart of the matter, in a way, in a certain sense, related to what I said at the beginning about the head status of the suffixes or not. The question is, starting in section 12 here, how does the adjective get together with the EST and ER suffixes? Certainly, most people would think that it's head movement. And so you start out in a familiar way with the suffix above the adjective. Let's abstract away from Bobolik's proposal that the superlative is higher than the comparative. We start out with the suffix above the adjective, and then we have head movement that brings the adjective together with the suffix in a way that, say, would recall Pollock's discussion of head movement in the case of verb raising in French versus English. Now note that head movement in the sense of Pollock's proposal, let's say for finite verbs in particular in French, that kind of head movement has the hardly ever explicitly discussed since so obvious property that that kind of head movement doesn't care what kind of complements the verb has. I suspect that Pollock didn't even mention that because it's so obvious and nobody would ever have thought the contrary. That is, the finite verb in French moves up in the way it does past adverbs, past negation. And it does that in a way that's completely independent of what kind of complements the verb might have. Whether the verb is unaccusative, unergative, transitive, doesn't matter. If the verb has complements, whether it has one or two, it doesn't matter. If the verb has complements, it doesn't matter whether the complements are DPs or small clauses or finite sentential complements or what. So if we were to think of comparatives and superlatives as being derived in a head movement fashion, in a way similar to what Pollock had for verb movement, we would expect that it wouldn't matter whether the adjective in question has a complement or not, or what kind of complement. But in fact, there seems to be a sharp difference between Pollockian head movement and what happens with suffixal comparatives and superlatives in English. In some cases, it clearly matters whether the adjective has a suffix, has a complement of some sort or not. For example, 63 is fine with non-suffixal comparative. They're more fed up with us now than they were before. The suffixal comparative in 64 is out, and the same is true for superlatives as in 65 and 66. 67, with no particle, we can have, that's the tiredest I've ever seen him. That's okay. But if we put in the particle, that's the tiredest out, I mean, against the background of the fact that we can say he's really tired out now. That's the tiredest out I've ever seen him, degrades substantially. Let's take 71. John is generally most full of himself when he's drunk. He's generally fullest of himself when he's drunk is pretty bad. 75 and 6 are interesting. In general, Mary is abler than John. That's possible with a certain interpretation. But if you add a complement, in general, Mary is abler to lift heavy boxes than John is, it becomes bad. 77 is interesting. It's of all the girls, it's Mary who's most like her mother. Fine. Of all the girls, it's Mary who's likest her mother. Terrible. So the observation is that suffixal comparatives and superlatives are not indifferent to whether or not the adjective has a complement of one. I'm using the term complement loosely, has some kind of complement following it. This fact clearly recalls, at least to me, it seems like the same fact, the fact that derived nominals very often are impossible with certain kinds of complements. So if we take 83 to 87, we get facts that look an awful lot like the facts that I just mentioned concerning superlatives and comparatives. Your tiredness out is terrible. John's fullness of himself is terrible. Mary's 86 is it particularly interesting. Mary's ableness is not in doubt, is okay. But Mary's ableness to lift heavy boxes is not in doubt, is terrible. So there's an initially plausible, that is, it's initially, not only initially, I would say, but it's plausible to think that the restrictions on suffixal comparatives and superlatives given just before, and these restrictions on derived nominals are of the same general sort. Now, the restrictions illustrated in 83 to 87, I mean, not the exact examples, but are of the sort that were discussed by Chomsky in Remarks on Nominalization. He touched on many subtypes of derived nominals. He had examples, well, let's say, I forget exactly what examples he had for acceptable ones, but acceptable examples of derived nominals with complements of one sort or another are given in 88 to 92. And then Chomsky, in a very interesting discussion, discussed the fact that in cases like those of 93 to 98, the derived nominals are not possible. And he tried to give an account of, I'll focus more on the ones, restrictions that he didn't mention, ones in 99 to 103. The verb provide is particularly interesting. My English allows, they provided the answers to the students and they provided the students with the answers. I allow the provision of the answers to the students is reasonably acceptable, whereas 99 itself is unacceptable. That is, the generalization is that with all verbs of the sort, provide somebody with something or deprive somebody of something, the corresponding derived nominal is impossible. And then there's 101. Particularly interesting is 102. Pseudo-passives are readily acceptable in English, pseudo-passives being passives in which what you, the object that you move to subject position is actually the object of a preposition. So with the verb allude, you can say that question has been alluded to in this talk. But the derived nominal counterpart, its allusion to in the talk is bad. Somewhat similarly for particle verbs. Now, the proposal that I made in this 2008 paper called Anti-Symmetry in the Lexicon was that all of these restrictions on derived nominals, that is the cases where the verbal structure is good and the corresponding derived nominal structure is bad, they all have to do with the fact that nouns don't project in the way that verbs do. Now, I don't really have time to go through all this. Let me just say that the more specific proposal in that paper was that, in agreement with many people, I would say it's an initial step, that if we take a derived nominal like the removal of the evidence, as in 104, that to express the relation between the root remove and the object, the evidence, we want to, of course, factor out the of, but everybody does that in one way or another. And we also want to factor out the al suffix. So we want to say that there's in the lower part of the structure, we have remove the evidence and the al comes in higher. But the question is, let me take that back. The al comes in some other way. The question is, what's the status of the al? A perfectly plausible hypothesis is that the al is a higher head, and that so we have al above remove the evidence, and then the verb remove raises by head movement and left adjoins to the al, producing removal and generating 104. But as in the prior discussion, if we can, again, bringing back Pollock's analysis of verb raising, if removal were really derived in a way parallel to verb raising, we would expect that the raising of remove to al would simply not care about what complements remove might have. Now, in the case of remove itself, there's no problem. But as we saw in the previous set of examples, from 93 to 103, there are all sorts of restrictions, and these restrictions are clearly not expected under a simple head movement, head raising analysis of derived nominals. So what I ended up proposing in this 2008 paper was that a derived nominal like the removal of the evidence in 104 is actually a relative clause structure, where what's relativized, that is what's moved up from within a lower clause-like constituent up to a higher position, is actually the AL morpheme itself, which I took to be fairly similar to a noun-like fact. And I related this to the question of phrases like the fact that John is here. The standard view is that the fact that John is here is not a relative clause, as opposed to the fact that I mentioned to you yesterday. But I tried to show that the fact that John is here can be analyzed as a relative clause based on a sentence like, John is here, in fact. You start out with something like, John is here, in fact, and you relativize fact. And there are all sorts of interesting details that I don't have time to get into. There's also a related discussion of the word way in English, which I will also skip over. The proposal, more specifically, if we come back to the restrictions that I've mentioned earlier, and we look now at 116, 117, which are good, as opposed to 118 and 119, which are pretty bad. The question is, why should, and these are cases that Chomsky had not discussed in Remarks on Nominalization. The proposal I made was that if you have a verb with two complements, the derivation, the relative clause-like derivation that I think is the right one, will only yield the right result, let's say in 116 and 117, if prior to the relativization operation proper, you scramble the prepositional phrase across the verb. So in the derivation of 116, my proposal was that the prepositional phrase from the children has to be scrambled at some relatively early stage in the derivation. And then the idea was to say that the reason that you don't get 118 or 119 is that the prepositional phrase in those cases is not readily scramblable. And this is shown in the contrast between 120 and 121. This is not exactly scrambling, but it's related to it. If you have a prepositional phrase of the from or to sort, the result is pretty good. But if you try to do the same thing with a prepositional phrase of the of or with sort, the result is much less acceptable. And that was the idea about why 118 and 119 are not possible. You could also pursue this with sentential complements, but I don't have time to. Particularly striking is the pseudo-passive fact. Sentential pseudo-passives are common in English, but as in 139 to 141, the corresponding derived nominals are impossible. That's strongly unexpected, I think, from the perspective of Chomsky's Remarks on Nominalization. But from the perspective of the analysis that I'm pursuing, which I don't have time to spell out in detail, we can give an account of 142 to 144 as follows. By previous reasoning, if we have a prepositional phrase inside a derived nominal, it has to scramble for the resulting derived nominal to be well formed. So if we were trying to derive 142, 3, or 4, we have to scramble the prepositional phrase beginning with to or about. And of course, we can do that because the simple derived nominal, an allusion to the problem or reference to that problem or thoughts about somebody, those are fine. But if we try to combine prepositional phrase scrambling with DP movement to spec of, let's say, spec of D, as in 142, 3, and 4, we find that we're going to have to do what looks like the kind of movement we see in pseudo-passives within a derived nominal. Now, you might think, well, that why not? That should be possible. But in fact, what happens in 142, 3, and 4 is that we have to do movement of the object of the preposition subsequent to the prepositional phrase having scrambled. And that brings us to the fact that if you scramble the prepositional phrase, you are in fact prohibited from moving the object of the preposition out any further. This is shown in English in 145 versus 146, where if you, now of course this isn't exactly scrambling, but it's close. If you topicalize a prepositional phrase to that sort of person in 145, you cannot subsequently strand the preposition to, as shown in 146, but even more striking, and as Norbert Korver recently confirmed for me, there's good evidence that in Dutch has scrambling in a way that English doesn't, so it's a closer match to the relevant discussion. If you scramble a prepositional phrase in Dutch, you cannot move the object of that preposition by R pronoun movement. So that there's good reason to think that the prohibition against a pseudo-passive counterpart in derived nominals, as illustrated in 142, 3, and 4, supports the idea that the derivation of 142, 3, and 4 must involve scrambling. But the fact that it must involve scrambling makes no sense at all from a head-raising perspective on derived nominals. It makes sense, I would argue, from a relative clause-like derivation of derived nominals. And now we get back finally, let's skip this whole section on ing. We get back to comparatives and superlatives. The idea now is to say that the fact that suffixal comparatives and suffixal superlatives share the kind of restrictions just discussed for derived nominals, namely that they're sensitive to what follows the adjective in the way that derived nominals are sensitive to what follows the verb, that suggests that suffixal comparatives and suffixal superlatives in English should involve a relative clause-like derivation of the sort that I had suggested for derived nominals. So one example quickly illustrated is in 168. And if we get back to one of the restrictions that we saw earlier, that you can say more fed up, but not fedder up, we can relate that now to the fact that up is not scramblable. That's actually something that Den Besten and Webelhout discussed in their 1990 paper, and that you can see, I think, in English, even though it's not exactly scrambling, in 169 versus 170, you can perfectly well prepose fed up in this particular kind of sentence, as in 169, but you absolutely cannot prepose up by itself. Let's skip the rest. And let me conclude by saying what I've tried to show here in the end is that Bobolik's idea that comparatives and superlatives are the suffixal forms of comparatives and superlatives in English are derived by head movement, with the comparative head coming in above the adjective and the superlative head coming in above that, cannot be right. Head movement is not what's at issue. Now, the question that in a way is more important to Bobolik, namely his idea that superlatives contain comparatives, there's no obvious conclusion about that aspect of his. The question is, from a relative clause perspective, what sense could we make of the idea that superlatives contain comparatives? And what sense could we make of Bobolik's notable generalization about suppletion? Those remain open questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Professor King. Thank you for this very inspiring, thought-provoking lecture. Our research groups, La Casa from UNICAMP and NEG from the Federal University of Santa Catarina, as well as our audience from Brazil and from abroad, really enjoyed your conference. Well, I'm Achilles from the La Casa Research Group at the University of Campinas, and I will be from now on reading the questions and comments to Professor Richard Kane. So if you have any questions or comments, just type them on the YouTube chat, or please send an email to zoomnacartografia@gmail.com. This email is being typed all the time on the YouTube chat, so don't worry if you're not able to hear it when I said. Well, Professor Kane, the first question has just arrived by email. I will read the question, and I am also putting the question for you on the YouTube chat. So it will take a while for me to paste the questions on the chat. Well, this question is by a student of La Casa. So I'm copying and pasting it on the chat so you can follow it. This is the first part, and I am putting the second part, and I am reading this now to our YouTube audience. So this question is from our La Casa research group at the University of Campinas, and a shy student is asking you the following question, Professor Kane. Professor Kane, thank you very much for this excellent talk. My question is actually a clarification one. At the very beginning of your presentation, you said that the ed suffix in English past tenses should be analyzed into two components, namely the vowel e as a theme vowel and the d as the past tense or participle morpheme. Minutes later, you stated that the e requires an incorporated n. And at some point, you ended up by suggesting that this E is actually a determiner. So that is the reason, if I got you correctly, why light verbs are incompatible with E in the past tense. They are not denominal, therefore they repel a determiner, the Z being a determiner. Did I get your point correctly?
Yes. But let me add that you may have noticed that this talk was entirely about English. But as always in syntax, we start from one language or a small number of languages. And we know that all other languages are relevant. In particular, it's relevant to ask whether the facts of other Germanic languages fit in with what I've suggested about English, whether the facts of Romance languages do, et cetera, et cetera. But I haven't tried to do that in this talk at all.
Okay, thank you. Well, there is a follow-up question to the one on the nature of this e-vowel in English from another student from our research group, La Casa, and I am copying and pasting it for you on the chat. Then there is another one by Gidon Vingard, and I will read it after this this follow-up question by one student of La Casa. So, Professor Kane, I may have missed something on the status of E in what looks like the ist suffix in superlatives. So, is this E also a determiner licensing English superlatives? I am thinking about your example in 36, where you've suggested the presence of an unpronounced E in the leftmost door, reanalyzed as 36, the to the left e-most door. But if it was a D, a determiner, the structure in 36 would involve two determiners, wouldn't it?
I don't know what the status of the E of EST is. I didn't propose that it was determiner. Having two determiners is not something that's unheard of. So let me just say that the question is a good question, and we need to think more about what the answer might be.
Okay, thank you very much. There arrived some questions by email. So the first one is by I am copying and pasting this for you on the chat, just a minute, please, by Guido van den Vangert. Sorry for the pronunciation of the surname. Could you expand in what exactly is the relativization step in 168?
The relativization step in 168 is the movement of the prepositional phrase consisting of a silent preposition plus the ER morpheme.
Okay. So now let me see. There is a message by Ana Maria Brito. Good morning to everyone, especially to Professor Richard Kane, with many, and she uses a Portuguese word, with many saudades of Paris and Salzburg. Thanks for your inspiring talk. Now, we also have an interesting question by Michelle Sheehan. Hi. I have a couple of questions for Richie. So I am copying and pasting these questions on the chat. Just a minute, please. Yeah, so this is the first part. Now the second part, just a minute, please. Well, it is a very big question, actually. Just a minute, please. One second. Yeah, now we get the whole question on the Zoom chat, Professor Kane. So I am reading it. Michelle Sheehan. Thank you, Michelle. Hi, I have a couple of questions for Richie. It was very interested in the claim you made early on that pairings with and without E differ in their aspectual properties. It has been claimed that some such pairs differ in being used in active versus passive contexts. And she gives some examples. We sped up, the car has sped, and this is grammatical, versus speeded up, now, which is ungrammatical. The film was or got speeded up, which is okay, which is fine. And the film was or got sped up, which is ungrammatical. I wondered whether this is expected for you, and if so, how and why?
I'm not sure I have the same judgments, but if there's a difference between active and passive, I don't have an immediate account, clearly. I'm not sure what the best answer is right off the bat.
Okay, so I am reading the second part of her question, just a minute, please. Also, not everyone has both forms of all these verbs. I actually only have sped, not speeded. I guess in those instances, there is no aspectual contrast to make. How do you model that? Is there a covert E? If so, do you make the prediction that if people have only one form, it will be the E-less form? This often seems to be true, but the list was long, and there are a few exceptions. Texted seems more common than text. Best, Michelle. Thank you, Michelle.
I don't know what to expect. I don't have a good sense of what the facts are about these doublets across different speakers of English. I've made one very specific proposal about this E question, namely that it requires a noun and therefore you don't get it with light verbs. But as I noted in part of the handout that I didn't actually get to, the converse of that is not so clear. I mean, what's clear is that there are verbs with no E that do seem to be denominal. So although E implies not, although E implies denominal, it doesn't seem to be the case that denominal implies E. And then if you ask, you know, within the universe of denominal verbs, which ones can get away without an E, I'm not sure what the answer is.
Okay, thank you. There is also a question, a related question by Van Kranenbrek, which arrives by email. I have just put it for you on the chat. I'm going to read. What is the status of the particle marker an, e.g., example, given, woven, etc., compared to ed? Is it also bimorphemic? Does it contain the same e?
It's not an accident that I didn't discuss EN very much. My impression is that I understand it less well than ED. I suspect that it's not bimorphemic and that it's not to be broken down into E plus N, and that it does not contain the same E as ED. But there's a lot more to be thought about. I mean, one obvious fact is that ED is found in both past tense and certain participles, whereas EN is found in certain participles, but never in the simple past. So there's a lot more to be thought about, not to mention the question of other Germanic languages here.
Okay. Thank you very much, Professor King. Thank you, Van Kranenbrek, for your question just sent. Well, Professor Kane, our two research groups discussed your antisymmetry and the lexicon paper, and we also have a question. I am going to put it on the chat. This is the first part, and the second part is this one I am going to put now. Yes, yeah, so I am reading the question to the audience. Professor Kane, thinking particularly of the derivation of a comparative like stronger at chess, also involves when it is built up a relativization step and a remnant movement step, this relativization step would feature a movement which reminds us of other structures you described in a couple of papers from the late 90s. So the conclusion is that the system you are proposing is computationally efficient as the derivations are ever repeating in distinct domains. And the question continues as the following. But when a cartographer assumes these types of movements, they are usually asked a couple of interesting questions which are quite the same in spirit. What are the motivations for movements, questions related to labeling, etc.? So our two research groups have discussed together this important issue of a Keynesian type of derivation, which is important for the work of our groups. So let us now, with all due respect, play the devil advocate role. Of course, we must say beforehand, we think this type of analysis is on the right track. But let me ask on behalf of the students of our two groups, one question we are very interested in your answer. And I am going to copy and paste the second part of the question. Just a minute, please. Sorry for the size of the question. Just a minute, please. Yeah, I am pasting it now. Yeah. Another important related question is, we normally see this remnant movement type of analysis when we have information structure involved to some extent. So we see when relative clauses are involved, as you suggested today, we also see it when focusing adverbs enter the structure, as in your 1998 syntax paper on only. And Nicola Munaro has a very interesting analysis based on that by integrating your analysis with the left periphery by Rizzi. Now, thinking on Guglielmo's work, Guglielmo Cinque's work on what he calls the left-right asymmetry, he turned to account for typologically attested orders, only to phrasal movements with and without pipe piping in the context of meaningless movements. So could we tentatively say that the remnant type of analysis is more related to information structure, while phrasal movements with or without pipe piping would be related to meaningless movements? Do you think that such a division of labor would be a property of universal grammar? Thank you.
Well, one thing to say is that remnant movements are phrasal movements. So presumably what's intended is the distinction between phrasal movements that are remnant movements and phrasal movements that are not remnant movements. I don't think I know the answer. The question of, say, the interpretive impact of scrambling in languages that have robust scrambling has been discussed for a long time, and I don't have a clear sense of what the correct answer is.
Okay, thank you. There is another question here by Professor Eloisa Salles from the University of Brasilia. I am putting it on the chat. Thank you for your inspiring talk as usual. My question is there a correlation between the restrictions involving removal and the privation and the fact that the corresponding verbal predicates involve a locative and a non-locative argument, respectively, the latter being a canonic ditransitive, allowing for a type of dative alternation, but not the former? Thank you.
I didn't, in the end, give an account of why scrambling with the of and with type prepositional phrases is much worse than scrambling with the to and from type. Obviously, it suggests that the internal structure of a verb phrase with an of or with type prepositional phrase is different from the internal structure of what are called canonical locatives. I'm not really sure what the difference is. One thing that's interesting is that in English, or at least in my English, you can see differences between the two types of verb phrases, even with respect to WH movement, in very complex sentences. For example, something like the person who I'm not sure what I should give to is pretty good for me. But the things that I'm not sure who I should provide with. Is worse. I'm not remembering. Let me just say that if you play around with these different kinds of verb phrases, you not surprisingly see that they have different behavior. How exactly that feeds into the scrambling difference is not so easy to say.
Okay, thank you. There is also a comment by Professor Ana Paula Scher from the University of São Paulo. Thank you very much, Professor Kane, for such an interesting talk. Thank you all for the discussion. And thank you, Ana Paula, for your message and support. Well, unfortunately, you no longer have time for more questions. We could stay here and keep discussing with you, Professor Kane, till the end of the day. So again, thank you very much for this inspiring talk. Our Zuna Cartografia team, a joint project by two research groups from Brazilian universities, so the La Casa Research Group from my university, the University of Campinas, and the NEG group from the Federal University of Santa Catarina, students of Professor Sandra Quaresemin, would like to thank our audience for all the support these 2 years we have been together. So, before wrapping up, I would like to ask João to set a video he has prepared with some pictures from each Zoom conference since the first conference by Guglielmo Cinque last year. The video is very short, so please stay connected with us these 2 more minutes. And I will ask Gabriel, to kindly share his screen so Professor Kane will be able to see the video.
Just a second, please.
Okay.
So I will stop Professor Kane's share screen, okay?
Okay, no problem.
Excuse me. Share sound. Share.
Yeah, we see your screen. Nice. So now, João, can I continue? Yeah. Okay. I would like to thank once more Professor Kenny for this excellent and inspiring talk. I also would like to thank Professor Sandra Corresemin for her partnership, and also our Zoom na Cartografia team, João Francisco, Isabela Flude, Gabriel Fuchsberger, Letícia Krieg, and Vitor Hochsprung. Sandra, could you say some words to wrap up the conference, please?
Yeah. I would like to thank you, Professor Richard Kane, for having accepted our invitation and for this brilliant lecture. Thank you. It was a pleasure to close the Zoom na Cartografia project 2022 with your honorable participation. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for having invited me, and thank you all very much for listening to the talk.
Thank you. I also would like to thank you, the audience, for being here with us and for the questions too. I hope to see everyone in the next year, and I wish you all happy holidays and happy new year.
Same to you.
Thank you. Thank you.